Yeah. temptation.
So I'm not, what does that make it? I'm not good at it. Anyway, she was buried in the old churchyard there. And she had such a full life, we couldn't show you all in one guided tour. But we will be taken to some of the buildings associated with the family and some of the events that changed her and moulded her into the famous woman she became.
Bit like Dickens' Christmas Carol with a ghost of Christmas past.
Yes, 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 a little bit. I don't expect me to wear no beard.
Only your whiskers.
My whiskers ain't none of your business.
A horseshoe that clatters lacks a nail. Aren't you going to introduce me then?
But I must. This here article is Jenny, and she used to be housekeeper to the Garretts during their time at Old House.
Chief cook and bottle washer, more like.
And she'll be tripping in with the grown-ups from time to time, I'm sure.
Keeping you on the straight and narrow, more like.
Right. Well, I suppose we'd better get started. Now, we'll start at St. Peter and Paul Church. A lovely building and edification, and one that the Garretts used to regularly attend.
Apart from where Mr. Newson fell out with the rector, then they'd all march down to the Union Chapel.
That's right. Yeah. And the year is 1849, 8 years after Mr. Newson arrived in Holborough, and his brother Richard has called for a meeting.
Barry, have you seen my fool of a brother?
Can't say I have, sir.
What about Lizzie and Louie?
I think they went walking with Miss Edgeware.
Edgeworth, you've never got it right.
Well, I suppose you did call Perth.
Newson, Richard Garrett, you're late. Perhaps, my dear Newson, it is you who are up early. Lovely to see you, Louisa. Are you keeping well?
By God's grace, fair, sir. Fair as can be expected.
Late. 5 minutes by my pocket watch, and it keeps perfect time, I assure you. Your business may run itself, but mine needs constant attention, and time is money. I do not have the advantages of being left a ready-made establishment by our father.
So you never cease to remind me. Always so sore, always so sore. And I assure you, sir, my business does not run itself, as you call it. Anyway, you haven't done so badly.
With no thanks to you.
And now, my dear, you promised.
My dear Louisa, to keep a civil tongue in his head, perhaps, or treat his elders and betters with a little more respect.
Elders and betters, I give respect where it's due.
Newson, please.
Perhaps you wouldn't mind leaving us, Louisa, my dear. Richard and I have some business to discuss, and things may get a little heated.
But I thought Louisa was fully au fait with your business interests. After all, does she not write all of your letters and keep your accounts?
I help where I can. My husband, as you know, is the driving force.
But given his total lack of ability when it comes to spelling and diplomacy, I believe I know who the real driving force of this partnership is.
All right, my dear, I will keep my temper, I promise you.
I will step apart a little, but I will not be far away. And please, gentlemen, remember, this is the house of God.
Perhaps you will pray for us.
Perhaps I will.
Right from the start, I always thought you made a good choice with Louisa Dunnell. But I always failed to understand what she saw in you. And I haven't really been mistaken.
And you with her sister?
Well, we are happy enough. I have no complaints.
But you didn't wish to see me to speak about our wives, I'm sure.
Well, yes, that since you want to skip the pleasantries, I'll get to the point. We've come a long way, Newson. Both of us.
Yes, only I have further to travel.
Oh, and I admire you for that. I do. You may not believe that, but I do. But you were always, you didn't have the advantages that our brother Balls and I had, but you were always such a hard worker. I knew that being the youngest wouldn't hold you back.
Well, I have my in-laws, the Dunnells, to thank for that.
Well, yes, admittedly, they set you up in business in London as a pawnbroker, but it was you who decided to move back to Aldborough and forge a business here. And look at you now. Master of a thriving cargo business and maltings, head of an expanding family, and master of almost all you survey.
I couldn't stay in Whitechapel. It wasn't good for the girls, all Louisa.
Yes, I was sorry to hear of the loss of your son.
Louisa took it badly. She needed a change of scenery.
And you?
I needed a new challenger. I love Suffolk, the coast is where my heart is. The sea, the air, it drew me back.
I meant about your son.
Sons aren't everything.
Oh, but they are, Newson. And you know that. My daughters, as sweet as they are, will be for marrying off. But my sons will continue the business. I intend to expand even further. Set up a long shop for the manufacture of steam engines and farm machinery. I shall have a stall in the Great Exhibition in London in 3 years' time. I shall charter some ships, take all my workers there. We have a good opportunity to show off all my new machinery. To conquer the world. My sons will benefit.
Do you know why I really moved to Aldborough?
The air of Whitechapel was killing you?
Partly. Partly I saw the chance for my daughters to grow up and thrive in a town that would benefit their health and their education.
Education?
Louis and Elizabeth have both had a governess these past 3 years.
That's a waste of money to me.
My girls are bright. And Elizabeth especially, she has such an inquiring mind.
So she might, but it just serves to frustrate her when it comes time to buckle down to the life of home.
Ah, Father, I am glad I'm back. Miss Edgeworth's insisting on her long and boring walks with us. However, Matt Coombs has invited me out on his boat, which of course I would prefer. Yeah. Oh, hello, Richard.
In this world, my, how you've grown.
Really? It doesn't seem to be going fast enough for me. Is Aunt Sarah with you?
No, not today. Have you been out walking?
Yes, by the shore. It's such a beautiful day.
By yourself? Surprised your father announced it.
Oh, Father doesn't mind, do you, Father?
I've always allowed the girls the freedom to wander. The fishermen keep an eye on them and exercise is good for the young.
Well, in girls.
Especially girls.
Your father tells me you have a governess.
Well, she calls herself that, but I'm afraid she has neither intelligence, imagination, or humour.
Really?
She relies on Magnus' questions historical and miscellaneous, which she makes us learn by rote. Tables of irregular French verbs and status centenii, I could do a better job standing on my head.
So, you intend to become a governess then?
I do hope not. It seems a tedious life. I should much rather learn a trade or help father in the malting business, or become a fisherman. Well, fisherwoman.
Well, isn't that man's work?
I don't see why it should be. It is only physical strength that women lack.
What about marriage?
Do you not intend marrying? Staying at home, bringing up children? What a tedious life. Mm-hmm. Father, can I go out fishing with Matt Coombs?
Well, if Miss Edgeworth has sent you us go for a walk, I will not cross her.
But she curves the same route every day. It's so tedious.
But the exercise is good. And it's what I pay Miss Edgeworth for. You do have to learn a little discipline, Lizzie. We cannot always do as we wish in life.
Well, you do, Father.
She's not wrong there. Be off. When you've had your walk, I will take you riding on Jepson. I'm sure you would prefer that.
Well, can Louis come too?
Of course she can. I'll run along.
He's a little wild now. I have to watch her, Newson.
She has a mind of her own, I grant you. But that's no bad thing. She's like me, bit of spirit. But she has outgrown her governess, I've known that for a while. which is why I intend sending both her and Louis to finishing school. There's one in Blackheath, it's run by the aunts of Robert Browning, no less. Has an excellent reputation. Everything is conducted in the French language.
Won't that be rather expensive?
It's no more than they deserve, and I shall make sure they have all the extras, including a weekly hot bath.
The bathing, Garrett, smart. You must be doing well.
I'm shipping 17,000 quarters of barley each year. There's coal and shipbuilding to add to that, and the maltings is thriving. I intend to build myself a new house on the hill yonder. Stables, granaries, piggeries, dairy, and a sweating house.
Sweating house?
Turkish bath, it's the latest thing.
You say so. Does sound like the most awful waste of money to me, but rather like educating girls.
I'm doing well, Richard, and I believe that my children should be treated equally and given the same chances, be they boys or girls. And Elizabeth shows such promise.
But when she marries, won't it all just go to waste?
What makes you think she has to marry?
What other choice has she? Which actually brings me to the reason why I wanted to speak to you. As you know, I am doing well too. My business is thriving. My hoes and drills are the best known throughout England. So I get into production and portable steam engines, I should be employing upwards of 2,000 men.
Well, spit it out, what does this have to do with me?
Well, I thought we might keep it in the family. Well, Elizabeth may be marrying one of my sons. See, well, when the time is right, I like her. I think she would fit well to life. And, well, she could finish her education, of course. They serve to calm her down a little. Maybe take off some of the rough edges. When she's of age...
Which one?
Sorry?
Which one of your sons did you have in mind?
Oh, it doesn't really matter. They're all good there. Frank, probably.
And what about the children? Do they not get a say? What if they don't get on?
Well, they're cousins, of course they'll get on.
We're brothers and we don't. But it's not mine. I get on with everybody.
Well, that's not the story I hear. So what do you think?
I think I might vote Liberal in the future.
What?
I'm sick of Conservative policies. They're all the same.
But you can't vote Liberal.
Just watch me.
Are you trying to be awkward?
Look, I did not bring daughters into the world, fine, bright daughters, in order to have them married off to your dullard set of sons.
Well,
if and when they get married, it will be to men who deserve them, who appreciate their intelligence and allow them to be persons of their own and not some slave or drudge. And moreover, to men they have chosen themselves. Don't mind, I have tradesmen's asses to kick and workmen to oversee.
Louisa,
please, we're leaving. And Barham! Bring the carriage round, man, and make it quick! And one last thing. If I see any of your sons sniffing around my daughters, I'll kick them from here to kingdom come! Understood?
Oh, yeah.
for his ever-growing family. But, of course, it's all flat now and all grown up everywhere. What I want you all to do is imagine what that was like. Well, that's brand new. It was like paddocks and gardens all around, and I stood on a crest of a hill, all open spaces. Very handsome, like myself, really. And from an open terrace, you could see the horizon 8 miles off. And to the left, you could see the church tower, and to the right, you could see the river all twisting and winding its way up through the marshes to Slaughton Quay. And that was from that house that the two young girls were herded off to Blackheath, London, for a formal education. And then later a tour of Europe, Paris, the Rhine, etc. I never got further than Beckles myself.
And then there was the great exhibition at Hyde Park. I remember it well because poor Millie was so upset she couldn't go.
Well, she was too young, weren't she?
Well, yes, but they bought her back a present. It was a bonnet, I remember. It was a bonnet of blue velvet with pink ribbons and
yes,
lace.
Yes, all right. Anyway, this home, old house, was to be Jenny's next home for the next 9 years. But she looked after and tended her brothers and sisters, but there weren't going to be enough of her in there, was it? So she carried on her education by using her brother's tutor, and she learned Latin and mathematics.
And she also spent a lot of time in the reading rooms. I wish I could read.
Well, the thing is, a lot of use you reading did.
Well, I don't know. Even a fool can put an idea in the head of a wise man.
Anyway, she kept friendship with all the chums she made at school. The front brothers were the Crow sisters at Gateshead and Miss Emily Davis. They were the front brothers. And that was these women that were to influence her and change the course of her life.
Bit prim, Miss Davies, didn't really warm to her.
It was alright. That's a bit serious, that's all. I suppose that's what becomes of being the daughter of a rector. Anyway, trouble was at hand, as it is often doing.
A little time, a chance to hatch a great deal of mischief.
Well, I didn't get going in the old garden now, when that reminds me, I must put some mutt on the master's rhubarb.
I've put custard on it, usually.
They're the best ones, the old one. Excuse me, madam. I'd be of assistance to you.
I'm here to see Miss Garrett.
Well, you're in luck, we've got plenty of them here. What ones do you want? Miss Josephine, Miss Millicent, Miss Lou, Miss Agnes, Miss Alice?
Miss Elizabeth Garrett.
Miss Elizabeth Garrett.
Oh, this is the time when she usually gives her talks. To the little ones about things in general.
Oh, yes. I remember. Who is it this time? Garibaldi? Oliver Cromwell? Lord Palmerston?
Not sure, miss.
I always thought George at 5 a little young for Palmerston.
I don't think anybody's ready at any age for Lord Palmerston, miss.
Emily, how lovely to see you! Oh, Barbara, this is my friend Emily Davies. She's come from far, so I'm sure she could do with some tea.
Yeah, I'm sure. Well, that's a taxing old journey all the way up from London, isn't it?
From Gateshead, even more so.
Oh, goodness. You did not travel all in one day.
No. I've been staying with our good friends the Crows. Oh, and with you, Ellen.
Oh, good. How is your brother?
Oh, he's well. He enjoys London. But the life of a rector is always taxing.
I'm sure it is. But then, of course, you would know firsthand, having been brought up in a rectory.
I'm the less said on that subject.
Barbara, do you think you could organise some tea?
Oh, yes, yeah, I'll see what I can do. But I have got to sort out the master's sweat house today, and they're going to take 5 minutes, let me tell you. Although I always think if he rubbed down a couple of horses, he'd work up a sweat just as well. Jenny!
Yes, Mr. Barbara?
Some tea for the ladies, if you please.
And do you think they'd like a bit of cake, too?
As you see fit, Jenny.
Because we haven't got anything.
Well, just tea then.
But I have got a nice bit of fruit loaf I've been saving for you, Mr. Barham, if you'd like to call at the kitchen at 4 o'clock.
That's handy. And I am the handy man.
And a little something we might have in our tea by way of support and sustenance against the cold if he gets me grim.
Right. But I have got sort out the master's sweathouse right then.
Well, I could come and help. Oh, I know how to get on the sweat good and proper.
My God. Look, you just sort out the master's tea and all that.
All right, Mr. Barham, if you say so.
Thank you, Barham.
Thank you, miss.
Anyway, I didn't come to talk about rectories or my brother. I want to know all. How did your trip to Dr. Blackwell go?
Oh, Emily, I think I can safely say it has changed my life.
Barbara Boudichon was right then. She was the one to send you to.
Barbara Boudichon is a marvel in herself. And the Englishwoman's Journal. Breath of fresh air. The conditions under which poor women are employed as governesses, seamstresses and factory hands, and the cry that goes up from all of our sex. It is work we want, room to work, encouragement to work, an open field with a fair day's work for a fair day's pay.
Yes, well, it helps having £300 a year from your father and being told to go off and do what you like in life.
But both of our fathers were supportive.
Yours might have been. My education was largely that of a clergyman's daughter. Latin lessons with my brothers and then getting along as best I could.
But your father did read your essays every week.
Well, yes, but I was forced to stay at home while my brothers went away to school.
In some ways, we are worse off than the poor women who have to work, be it in menial tasks. The articles on women such as Florence Nightingale's and Dr. Blackwell was so inspirational. We're expected to do literally nothing with our time. There is a revolution happening, Emily. Not in the mine or the factories, but in the provincial drawing room.
Why, she has turned your head.
Before hearing Dr. Blackwell speak, I was a young woman living at home like you, like millions of us, with nothing to do, with what authors call comfortable circumstances. Well, I was wicked enough not to be comfortable. I am full of energy and vigour and all the discontent that goes with unemployed activities. Everything seemed wrong with me.
And now?
Everything is clear. I'm going to be a doctor.
Oh, what?
I have decided that medicine is my calling, though I scarce feel equal to it. But if Dr. Blackwell, who is blind in one eye and looks so frail, can achieve so much. Do you know she graduated in New York alone, without money or influence, and yet she has set up a dispensary amongst immigrant women in the slums.
Oh, my dear, I knew she would persuade you. God works in mysterious ways.
Oh, no, do not bring God into this. This is my head and my reason, not my heart. I am no Florence Nightingale. Although Mother prays nightly that I might be converted to her pious ways, I've never felt drawn to a life of devotion such as she has.
So Elizabeth Blackwell has turned your head on her own merits.
Oh, she is so inspirational. I'm so glad that you encouraged me to go and listen to her.
Young ladies all of every clime, especially those in Britain, who chiefly occupy your time in novels and in knitting, whose highest skills are but to play, sing, dance, and French to clack well, reflect on the example, pray, of
excellent Mrs. Blackwell. Think you had a brother ill, or a husband, or a lover, and you could prescribe a draught or pill whereby he might recover. How much more useful this would be, O sister, wife, or daughter, than handing him beef tea or gruel and toast of water?
Oh, dear.
Oh, Emily, as you know, I've always been very restless. I've always felt like I needed something to give meaning to my life.
Well, women in this country, in this age, women of the genteel classes, we're consigned to the scrap heap almost from the time we're born. Nothing is open to us except marriage and family. or looking after siblings and then elderly parents, boredom on a grand scale.
Dr. Blackmore did speak of these things, active occupation, personal standing, social respect, and the companionship of intelligent co-workers, both male and female.
Well, she's a passionate speaker. But why medicine?
Well, half the ordinary medical practice lies with women and children, and yet they have to endure being examined and treated by men. Well, no one person can do everything, so I've decided to make it my passion to help women.
And in this way, you can help them twofold. You can give them an opportunity other than the despised governess, and you can provide women to treat women.
Exactly.
But you do know how hard it's going to be. I mean, you have a smattering of an education. I know you have French and a little Latin and a little maths, but you're going to need so much more. And Dr. Blackwell studied and qualified in America.
Yes, but she is on the medical register here now.
Yes, I know, but that's awoken the dragon and shut the door to further women being admitted to the register without a qualification from a university in this country. There are no routes into further education, let alone a career as male-orientated as medicine. No, women will get nowhere until we're as well-educated as men.
Dr. Blackwell, she did speak of the need for women to have the same qualifications as men in order that they can hold their own in their chosen field.
Exactly. And that's why I intend opening a university college.
Oh, Emily.
Otherwise, we'll always be criticised as less intelligent and therefore not capable, because all we've been taught to do is sit and draw.
It is no wonder that those who have not learnt to do anything cannot find anything to do.
Well, in the words of Mary Wollstonecraft, it is time to start a revolution among female nouns and to restore their less dignity and to make them labour. And by reforming themselves, reform the world.
Here, here.
Emily!
Oh,
I thought I heard voices.
My dear, of course you're looking well.
Louise in love.
Oh, see?
It's all right to say now. You are engaged.
Oh, anyone I know?
Well, it is not our cousin Richard.
Oh, he did.
Oh, mother approved. Father thought it had far from perfect match. You know he's not speaking to his brother now since they fell out over politics.
Oh.
And he cannot bear the thought of being nice to him over a wedding breakfast.
Well, who then? Oh, come, be out of it.
James Smith,
brother of our friend Blackie.
Oh, a lovely family, I approve.
And when will this be? Soon, as soon as James has found us a house. We are to live at Bayswater.
I'm very happy for you. But Lizzie, I thought Cousin Richard had his eye on you.
Oh, I don't have time for relationships. And anyway, look at Louis. She is beautiful where I am plain.
Oh.
She is good-natured where I'm strong-willed.
True.
Of course she should find a husband.
Oh, come now. I'm older than you, so it is only right that I should find somebody first. But I promise, you will not be far behind me, Lizzie.
When you have children, Louis, I will be their best aunt. But until that time, my hopes lie in other directions other than having to look after another man.
I must go and get changed. I will see you again at dinner.
Of course. So, Lizzie, you will be head of the house once Louis has gone. How will that fit in with your plans?
Well, I have to speak to Father, of course. I know he expects me to take over the running of the household now that Louis is going, but there's so much to do.
Yes.
But the younger ones are getting older all the time, and Father has always encouraged us girls with our education, always treated us as equals to the boys. I cannot see him being anything but supportive.
Mm. And your mother?
Yes. Well, she may take a little more persuading.
Lizzie, Mother says it's time you're getting ready for dinner, and she wants to know if your friend is staying.
Minnie, you know Emily Davies, don't you?
Of course. Lizzie, will you?
Of course I will.
So what's next then, once you've won your father's approval? Will you go to America to get qualified, do you think?
Oh goodness, no. That defeats the object. It's here we need to change things. We need education, an occupation, a profession. No, I intend to go to a medical school in London and get my degree somewhere. I want to lead the way in medicine. You can lead the way in education.
Well, what can I do?
Yes, we must find a job for Millie.
Ah, yes, Millie. You can get us the vote.
Oh, yes.
Your tea, miss. Oh, hold you hard, Miss Jenny. Allow me to assist you with the pouring of same. Just a minute, Miss Jack. What is this? This is just water, hot water.
Sorry, Mr. Barham. Must have forgotten to put tea leaves in. I'll do it immediately. Oh, wait a minute. I know why I forgot tea leaves.
And why was that?
We haven't got any.
See what I have to put up with. Now look, you said a pretty brainy lot to me. Well, one or two of you. And you have gleaned by now that Miss Elizabeth now has a name and she has a course. But she now has another hurdle to climb, convincing her parents. Let's eavesdrop and see how she gets on with her father.
A little wit may serve a fortunate man.
Yeah, well, there's no danger for you there, then, is there?
Father, you wanted to see me.
You've upset your mother, Elizabeth.
I'm sorry to hear that, Father.
She's taken to her room and won't stop her weeping. Nothing I say seems to make any difference.
And what am I meant to have done?
It's this business of you being a doctor. It won't do, my girl. It's out of your league. It's out of any woman's league.
Dr. Blackwell has succeeded.
Dr. Blackwell, I'm sick of the sound of that woman's name. Do you know what is written of her? It is impossible that any woman whose hands reek of gore can be possessed of the same nature or feelings as the generality of women.
Rubbish, and I'm surprised you take note of it, Father. Women have been practicing medicine for centuries before men came along and took it away from them. And Dr. Blackwell is the calmest, quietest person, and she has much dignity about her.
But she is American, and that's different.
Oh, no, she isn't. She just studied in America because there are no openings here.
Well, that must tell you something.
Yes, it tells me that there is an awful lot of work to be done in order to change opinions.
Your mother says it's against God's order.
Against God's order? Did God not give women gifts the same as men? Brains and abilities?
But there is men's work and there is women's work.
And what of nuns? They have been tending to the sick for centuries. And what of the work that Florence Nightingale is doing?
No problem if you wanted to be a nurse. I'm sure I could persuade your mother of that.
I don't want to be a nurse.
Why ever not?
Because I would rather earn £1,000 a year than I would £20 a year.
If it's just about the money,
And your life hasn't been. You taught us to strive for the best, the most. You did not move to Aldborough for your health, Father.
A woman's place is in the home.
But why did you allow me to be educated? Why did you allow me to explore the world?
I thought it would help you to hold your own when you got married.
Oh, poppycock. The likelihood of me marrying is remote. Oh. And anyway, it's just not good enough.
Waited. Nothing much being expected of you.
No, I know. It's nothing. As a woman, just nothing is much expected of you.
But I do expect a lot of you. Who is meant to look after the household now that Louis is married? There's the seasonal moves back and forth from the house at Snake Bridge. There's the children to look after and the servants to mind. I had hoped in time you would become clerk to me or governess to the children.
But that's all such small beer, Father. And anyway, governesses are despised. Oh, I'm like you, Father. Can you not see that? Did you think in such small terms when you moved from Leiston to London? And when you moved us all from London to Albury in that small boat with all our worldly possessions on and nothing else but your name? Now look at you. Boat building, shipping, cargo handling, malting.
I've always played by the rules.
Oh, no, you haven't. Your rows with the whole of Aldborough are legendary, and we change churches more times than the seasons. But I do remember, Father, the year of the great storm, when you held firm, Cox and George Cable were swept over and drowned. You took his place, you saved those sailors. I've always admired you, Father. You're not an easy man to live with sometimes, but it's your drive and determination that runs through my veins.
Ah, Ed, I knew it was a mistake to teach you riding. Let you play with the fishermen's children on the beach. And letting you study with your brothers.
Do you know what it's like to be told that anything like original research or profound learning is the pursuit of men alone? That women with their minds and bodies so frail will always fail? I have waited for 5 years to find something that would give meaning to my life, and I have found it in medicine. I don't know how I'm going to go about it. I know it'll be a long, hard struggle, but I know it will be hard without you on my side.
What about your mother? I'm afraid she will pine herself to death.
I think mother is stronger than she looks. And if she knows that you are supporting me, well, she will come round in time.
So where do you propose to begin?
Well, I will move to London, and I will stay with Louis. I intend to enroll at the Middlesex Hospital as a student. If they refuse me, I will go as a volunteer, and I will observe and learn as much as I can.
Well, you know that business is difficult at the moment. Money's tight, my girl, with my expansion of the maltings. I've had to curtail Millicent's education. Beef is off the menu.
I do not ask anything material of you, Father. Just your blessing.
You'll break your mother's heart.
I think that most unlikely.
Well, let me think about it. I'll let you know my decision in due course. But, well, we could be waiting here ages, couldn't we, for his decision? Has anybody got any saucy stories while we're waiting, huh?
There's a note from your father, miss.
Go on, quick.
Jenny, what does it say?
I know, miss. Can't read.
Barham, could you read it for me, please?
Right. Now, that's a much better choice. Lovely ringing voice, says Mr. Barham. He reads the paper to me of an evening when we're alone together. Yeah, maybe I shouldn't have said that.
Just give me the letter, woman.
Now, I have resolved in my mind, after deep and painful consideration, not to oppose your wishes and views. And as for expenses involved, I will do all I can in justice to my other children to assist you in your study.
Oh, Father! I must go and pack before he changes his mind.
A good, strong girl. Well, that's a bit of luck, we're here already. I mean, not far to go.